Hi friends, welcome to Smart News Digital. Let's have discussion for the date August 16th, 2018. Today we are going to see all these topics. Today's first topic is with human space flight, India to push frontiers. Yesterday's during Independence Day speech, Indian Prime Minister green flagged human space flight program called Gaganyaan in the year 2022. This particular mission is estimated at the cost of 9,000 crore. Most of the critical technologies that are required for this human spaceflight program are already available with ISRO, and hardware required for the project are ready, and they have been demonstrated by the ISRO's various centers. ISRO would now stitch them all the project into a complete one and present a comprehensive report to the government to get its approval. Once this project gets accomplished, India would be a fourth nation to circle the Earth after the Soviets, Americans and Chinese. In 1984 itself, India's first astronaut wing commander Rakesh Sharma has orbited Earth as part of Soviet mission, but this time India is going to do in its own. In the last few years, ISRO did a lot of groundwork for this particular project as part of R&D. ISRO developed most of the critical technologies needed for this human spaceflight program. It also demonstrated flight of crew model and its re-entry in 2014 itself. On July 5, that is last month, an experiment for emergency escape of astronauts called pad abort test was conducted. It will be repeated at higher distances also. The critical elements of this human space flight program are environment control and life support systems. These both are very important to make the crew capsule livable and to make the flight safe for the astronauts. There are other aspects also like food and hygiene, and space suits for astronauts are being developed by ISRO. Existing facilities are not enough to conduct human space flight program. So, the necessary facilities that are needed to conduct this program are being added or upgraded to few centers of ISRO hereafter. This particular spacecraft is going to be monitored by 24/7 from the ISRO Telemetry Tracking Command Center in Peenya. This is located in Bangalore. A new dedicated control center for human space program would be set up at ISTRAC. This is also located in Bangalore. It must be tracked globally through ISRO stations or other countries. The launch pad at the Sriharikota is going to be enhanced. Much of the work related to ramping up of infrastructure and supply of hardware would be outsourced to private sectors also. Today's second topic is Assam rejected move to shrink area under AFSPA, Armed Forces Special Power Act. Parliamentary Standing Committee have tabled a report in Parliament. According to this report, security situation in northeastern states is improving. With improvement in security situation, areas under AFSPA have to be reduced. So government is considering we have to gradually reduce the areas under AFSPA, especially in the states of Assam and Meghalaya. But the states Assam and Meghalaya are not agreeing with the central government move. Already for the last 2 years, Home Ministry is trying to reduce the area under AFSPA, but it is facing a stiff resistance from the Army and Defence Ministry. 2 days back, over 300 Army officers moved to Supreme Court. They challenging registration of FIRs against them for operations in areas where AFSPA in force. As per Section 3 of the Armed Forces Special Power Act, it can be invoked in places where the use of armed forces in aid of the civil power is necessary. Armed Forces Special Power Act empowers Army and Central Forces personnel deployed in disturbed areas to kill anyone acting in contravention to the law. That is, if somebody goes against the law, somebody taking law and order in their own hands, then Armed Forces, Central Forces can kill them, can arrest them. These armed forces can search any premises without a warrant, and this particular act provide cover to these forces from prosecution and legal suits without center's sanction. Today's third topic is probing an amendment. Recently, amendments have been brought up by the government in the laws on corruption, which could have far-reaching effect. This particular article discusses on two aspects, that is, requiring prior approval for initiating investigation itself. Then secondly, prior sanction for prosecution of public servants. Section 6A of the Delhi Special Police Establishment Act has been amended. Already there is a provision according to that if you want to initiate investigation against joint secretaries and above, you need to get a prior approval. But this particular immunity extended to all categories of public servants. That means if you want to initiate investigation against any public servant, you need to get to prior approval. This is a cause of concern. Till now, under Section 19 of the Prevention of Corruption Act 1988, previous sanction of the competent authority was required to prosecute public servants. This particular immunity again extended to retired officers also. If some officials involved in corruption, CBI wanted to initiate an investigation, but CBI cannot do on its own. It needs to get a prior approval, which is not a correct approach. Under the law of the land, the police has unfettered jurisdiction, that is unhindered jurisdiction, to initiate investigation into a crime or acts of corruption. That is, once it gets a credible information, it can start investigation on its own. It need not to wait for approval. Time and again, Supreme Court itself says that even courts cannot interfere in the exercise of power by the competent investigation agency. However, political authorities time and again trying to appropriate this power from the CBI. Single directive was brought out by the Rajiv Gandhi government. This was the first step, first safeguard to the senior officers, but it was restricted to senior officers only. A long legal battle was fought in the Supreme Court challenging this particular single directive, and the Supreme Court eventually cancelled this, that is set aside this, in the Vineet Narayan case. Supreme Court observed that all the powers of the ministers are subject to the condition that none of them would extend to permit the minister to interfere in the course of investigation. That is, the minister may handle the agency. That doesn't mean the agency's powers, the agency's rights can be interfered by the minister. Concerned officers are to be governed entirely by the mandate of the law and the constitution and the statutory duty cast upon them. That is, CBI or police officials have to follow the rules and regulations and the constitutional guidelines given to them. Any investigation should be conducted in free and fair manner. No investigation should be hindered by any officials or any government officers, ministers, etc. Once the investigation is complete and the investigation officers are coming up with a report, then only other authorities should come into picture. But even after the directive, that is single directive by the Rajiv Gandhi government, was set aside, the political class brought it back by the CVC Act 2003. Again, this led to a protest and was challenged before the Supreme Court. In 2014, Supreme Court set aside this provision also. The Supreme Court observed that the very power of the CBI subverted and impeached by the Section 6A. Today's fourth topic is making National Health Protection Mission work. The government is finally recognizing the linkages between healthcare and economic development. Without providing healthcare to the citizens, economic development, economic prosperity is not possible. National health policy does not recognize right to health because it cannot be implemented since the burden of cost is there. There is an increasing awareness that it is unsustainable for a country of 1.3 billion people to rely on household savings to pay for health expenditure. Under this National Health Protection Mission, state governments have to execute this. That is, state governments have to administer this scheme. Why state government have to administer? Because all the Indian states are not same with respect to health sector. For example, Tamil Nadu health sector is far superior than the UP health sector. Reaching a consensus on treatment cost through transparent consultative process is very important for the smooth and steady rollout of this particular scheme. A large-scale information technology network for cashless treatment should be set up and validated, because wherever cash is involved, leakage is involved, corruption is involved. So it is better we can go for cashless treatment. So government have to increase its public health spending to 2.5% of GDP at the center and 8% at the state level. Let's see some aspects of this particular scheme. This will provide medical coverage of 5 lakh per family per year. This will benefit 10 crore families chosen through socio-economic caste census, mainly rural poor and identified urban workers. 10,000 crore has been allocated for this particular project. And once this is implemented, this would be the world's largest government-funded healthcare insurance scheme. There are some medical institutions which are less ethical in nature. They are ordering unnecessary treatments to get benefit from the insurance. So we have to create an ombudsman to deal with the compliance from the customers. We can give one suggestion that we can extend this scheme to all children and senior citizens. We have to take all the necessary steps to reduce out-of-pocket spending for health. Today's fifth topic is fear is not the key. India's stock markets are booming with Bombay Stock Exchange Sensex touching new heights. 25 years ago, SEBI was set up. Since then, regulation of security markets have been evolving. Front-running, insider trading, shady accounting practices are some of the issues that are prevailing in securities market. It is tantamount to window dressing firms. A TK Vishwanathan committee submitted its report to curb illegal practices in the market and ensure fair conduct among the investors. This committee suggests that SEBI should be empowered to act directly against perpetrators of financial statements of fraud. This means that SEBI can not only act against listed companies, it can also act against auditors if they involve in financial statements fraud, according to this committee's report. This committee also suggests that SEBI should be given power to grant immunity to whistleblowers who help uncover illegal activities. That is, illegal activities are present in securities market also. If somebody come up with a report, if somebody informs to the SEBI, they have to be protected. This report goes to the great extent of recommending that SEBI should be given powers to tap even phone calls. This is really a cause of concern because SEBI should not be given too much of powers. The intention is SEBI should be empowered in such a way that we have to curb illegal practices in securities market. That doesn't mean we have to give enormous amount of powers according to this particular article. Greater executive powers is being suggested. It can really help a regulator to take a faster action, swifter action against offenders. Instead of relying on government bodies such as Ministry of Corporate Affairs, SEBI is better placed to understand the complex nuances that are present in financial market fraud. Government agencies may not be able to understand the nuances of financial market, but SEBI, which is a regulator, can understand the nuances. So it can be empowered to take more actions. A strong regulator serves a good deterrent to trons in the market, but banking on fear too much could also scare away genuine investors. SEBI is functioning well. It is taking all the necessary action to curb illegal activities that are present in the securities market. That doesn't mean all its actions were always correct. For instance, last year SEBI ordered to impose restrictions on the trading of shares of 331 companies, suspecting that they are laundering money. But this was considered as a hasty move. SEBI is now considering a cap on trading by retail investors based on their assessed net worth. This particular committee's report also suggests that it may even consider any trading by players beyond their known financial resource as fraud. That means if I have an income worth 10 lakh from known sources and I am trading worth 12 lakhs, then this particular 2 lakhs will be considered as fraud. But this could lead to undue harassment of investors. Granting more teeth to enable market regulator, that is SEBI, is fine. It is to fulfill its primary role of protecting investors. Okay, but empowering it with the right tools is necessary.